In fact, just to continue your idea along consumer rights, when I was researching an article on that, I discovered that the first thing, or one of the first things the Bolsheviks did after 1917 was ban product branding. And immediately, quality of products collapsed, because producers of then indistinguishable products and services had no incentive to invest in the brands and reputation that are so important to consumer welfare. So, yes, I mean, we are dealing with a Minister of Health who is determined to control everything we do. And with the help of the team at the FMF, I'll be arguing against that. But if you look at those areas of interest of mine, privatization, tax, income taxes in particular, labor market and labor market reform, labor law reform, and also privatization, the common thread running through all of them is that they are methods of empowering the black middle class. Because what's clear to me in my deliberations is that the central social, political, and economic event of the 21st century will be the expansion of the black middle class. It's going to bring all sorts of wonderful benefits to South Africa. The isolation of the radical left, the return of market economics as the basis of teaching in South African universities. There are just many wonderful things that the emerging black middle class is going to bring to us, like political stability, greater demand for effective government services, and so on. I'm going to explore some of that tonight. I'm going to end my talk on the black middle class. But I want to give you a little bit of history, and economic history as a field is enjoying a certain revival in the world. There's some incredibly good thinkers, Nobel Prizes recently awarded in the field, and certainly economic history is becoming more important, primarily because of the barrenness of the established methods of economics, the empirical, mathematical, formulaic treatments of economies and economic entities. So economic history is a fascinating and very interesting field. Given my background in econometrics, I've been seen as a bit of a traitor from the empirical paradigm. But I think any exploration of economic history will produce value for you, will provide great interest for you in your further explorations of the market mechanism. So I want to go back to the Cape of Good Hope. And the point I mean to make here is that miscegenation, the mixing of races, certainly in the Cape of Good Hope, but to some extent also on the Witwatersrand, was the overwhelmingly natural condition of the first 200 years of life in South Africa, life of Europeans in South Africa. And I just want to pick out a couple of key points, but that's really all I mean to indicate, is that racial segregation socially was far more unnatural than social integration and racial mixing was natural. So between 1652 and 1670s, there were a few marriages between what were then called Dutchmen and so-called Christianized, so-called Hottentot women. But from the 1670s onwards, which had to do with issues around European women coming to the Cape of Good Hope, by the 1670s, miscegenation or racial mixing had grown to such an extent that three-quarters of female slaves' children had white fathers. So this is a period of just over 20 years in the establishment of the European presence in the Cape. And from there, racial mixing just exploded. So that by 1685, marriage had become a political issue between white men and slave women, and it was prohibited. But the way that miscegenation then occurred was that from the 1680s to as far as the 1740s, there was a kind of institutionalized concubinage at the slave lodge of the Dutch East India Company. It was an extraordinary time, something that Cape Town is re-experiencing and has re-experienced since 1994. It's a different group of people. People talk in the Cape at the moment about the pink rand, which is the buying power of gay and lesbian and bisexual and transgender and asexual and intersexual people. But there is an extraordinary kind of mixing, social mixing going on in the Cape today. And I think really the experience of the Cape was that except for the 45 years of apartheid, racial mixing was absolutely and thoroughly natural in the Cape Colony, what became the Cape Colony. So by the 1780s, 1/6 of the inhabitants of the Cape Colony were mixed race. By the 1810s, distinct communities of what by that time had become known as Cape Coloureds had settled along the Orange River. And between 1925 and 1946, just to give you an indication of the explosion of this phenomenon, 70% of marriages between Africans and Coloureds and 13% of marriages were between whites and colors. It was an extraordinary time in the spontaneous emergence of racial mixing. It's quite interesting to look at the word, which in English seems so anodyne, miscegenation. In Afrikaans, it has a much more, much greater resonance. It's called verbasterung, which I suppose means bastardy. Or something like that. But certainly the phenomenon didn't acquire any of the social implications that it formed after 1946. So it's amazing that 70% of marriages were between African and coloureds over that period, and 13% of marriages were between whites and colours. And the rest, as they say, is history. Cape Town today is returning to that mixed society, and I think it's of great interest to us to observe how free from unnatural legislation, unnatural policing of people's private lives, the Cape is returning to that libertine, laissez-faire, social environment. So where did this picture end? I mean, what I'm saying here might be news to you, but it's not news to economic historians. This is very much well understood by historians and economic historians who don't always see things the same way. But where did things become difficult between the races? And it was certainly on the Witwatersrand. So we know the basic history. The basic history is that between 1881 and 1886, gold was discovered in the Northern Territories. And between 1895 and 1940, the Witwatersrand, stretching all the way to Welkom from Johannesburg, produced up to half of the world's gold production in a year. And I want to develop the consequences of that a little bit, because the first thing that occurred with the gold rush, first east and then in what we today call the areas around Johannesburg, when that gold rush started, very large numbers of prospectors flocked to South Africa to prospect on the gold fields. And very soon it emerged that the kind of gold available in South Africa required capital equipment and machinery was not of the alluvial kind that was initially suspected. And as a result, all of these prospectors who'd come to South Africa in search of their fortunes, these prospectors found themselves dispossessed of their prospecting rights by very large concerns who could raise capital in Cape Town and later in London to develop these capital-intensive mines. And it won't surprise you then that many of these prospectors took employment in the gold mines. And that switch from being a prospector to an employee, an entrepreneur to an employee, had a dramatic change or effect on the landscape in the Witwatersrand. So much so that by 1904, European migrants started introducing the trade unions that they had grown up with in Europe. And so 1904 was the first union of gold miners in the Transvaal. And as I say here, we had deep level mining with capital intensity requirements, which produced a rise in the need for skilled labor. The flock of skilled European labor, and with them they brought the trade unions. By 1911, these trade unions, what I'll call the white trade unions, had gathered sufficient momentum that politically they tried to introduce racial segregation legislation. And what's interesting about that time is that the Chamber of Mines opposed the first racial segregation legislation on the grounds that there was such a shortage of skilled Europeans to work on the mines that they needed to introduce more skilled, better trained, more experienced Africans onto the mines. And it was from that set of circumstances that racial segregation exploded in South Africa. But make no mistake, it was not the caricature that was made of racial segregation later in the fanatical period after Dr. Verwoerd, Prime Minister Verwoerd. It was an attempt by white mine workers to exclude from the workforce black mine workers who quite naturally were acquiring experience and skill and most importantly managerial ability. I'm going to talk about the parallels between that union experience and the union experience we've had since the 1980s because I think something similar is playing out. But the point I want to make at the moment is that racial segregation in South Africa has a history in white employees through their trade unions opposing the entry of competition from black workers into the mines. And the important thing there is that the Chamber of Mines opposed this. The view today is that the Chamber of Mines representing white monopoly capital was in favor of racial segregation. Why they would do so economically makes no sense, because they wanted to introduce into the labor force solutions to the shortage of skills among white mine workers. Anyway, so that was basically what occurred, and you may remember the Rand Rebellion. The Rand Rebellion was a movement supported by what was then the Young South African Communist Party, the same one that today is part of the tripartite governing alliance, ruling alliance. This Communist Party was back in the 1910s a white supremacist organization. So people get it wrong. They get the Communist Party's origins wrong. They get Chamber of Mines' attitude toward racial segregation wrong. They make many historical errors of fact in their interpretation of what has occurred. And of course, it's very self-serving to the radical left and their interpretation of history. But it's factually wrong, and I don't think I'm controversial in that. I may be controversial in presenting it this way, but it's well understood by economic historians and most historians that this is what occurred. So if my first point is that racial mixing, social mixing, libertinism and laissez-faire was the order of the day for nearly 300 years in the Cape. The origin of racial segregation was the vested interests of white unionists to keep black workers out of the workforce. And the hysteria that followed in the form of increasingly bizarre policies to segregate the races was a sign of how unnatural that segregation was. For many of you, for some of you perhaps this won't be history, but I just want to explore a couple of details of the Rand Rebellion. Marikana is not the most interesting or the most important or the most deadly labor confrontation we've had in South Africa. In 1922, opposition to the entrance of blacks into the gold mines had risen to such a fever point that thousands of mine workers, well over 10,000, but the exact number is unknown, thousands of white mine workers occupied the town halls of Brakpan, Springs, Benoni, and several other places. And these occupations were at the time seemed to be part of a communist conspiracy, and Prime Minister Smuts sent in troops to reclaim the town halls. Over 200 mine workers were killed, white mine workers. Over 2,000 were hospitalized in the ensuing chaos. And most historians today draw a direct line between Smuts's failure in the Rand Rebellion and the emergence of a white supremacist, labor-oriented, trade union-supporting national party. There's a direct line to that and then all of the events that follow. Now what I want to do is draw some similarities between the emergence of the white middle class out of poverty during the course of the 1900s. I want to draw a parallel between that and the emergence of the black middle class out of relative poverty in the 2000s. It's interesting to me how the emergence of the black middle class in some ways mirrors the emergence of the white middle class 100 years earlier, but in some ways is actually occurring way faster than anyone could believe. And then I'm going to draw some conclusions about the policy platforms that people pursuing the black middle class votes, like the DA and others, policy proposals that they could utilize to attract this growing black middle class. So, the first thing to look at, I suppose, is that the black working class was the feature of economic history from the 1980s onwards. In 1983, South Africa was relatively important as a mining producer around the world. We were somewhat significant in the production of agricultural products. Agriculture and mining represented about 21% of economic activity in the early 1980s. And manufacturing, supported to some extent by exchange controls and other things, manufacturing protected by subsidies and tariffs and all sorts of things, manufacturing expanded. And with the expansion of manufacturing emerged this phenomenon of the black working class. Now, the black working class has very interesting characteristics. For example, where the middle class is concerned with upward job mobility, advancement of their careers. The black working class, and the working class in general, is obsessed with job security, retaining jobs that are in some way precarious, rather than in advancing through jobs that are progressively more interesting and remunerating and so on. So the black working class has been in decline now since about 1986. I just want to draw a couple of things to your attention. The first is that unionization has been declining. This is the first consequence of the dwindling working class. So unionization as a percentage of the workforce in 1994 was 45%. 45% of the national workforce was unionized in 1994. In 2014, today, unionization is 25% of the workforce. And what's interesting is if you exclude civil servants, 81% of whom are unionized, if you exclude civil servants, only 1 in 8 workers in South Africa is unionized today, around 12%. So one of the things we've observed among the black working class is declining unionization, and I would say that that is a symptom of the emerging black middle class. And if you think about the economic calculus for a trade union, it's really between revenues from membership and costs from organizing members. So economic modernization and economic growth and development has wiped out union membership. I mean, just to give you an example, last year alone, union membership fell by 300,000 or 9% of the total membership, and this year to date, it's fallen by 12% further. It's being decimated. And I can give you an alternative view then on why NUMSA and COSATU have split. It's got nothing to do with Vavi's romantic dalliances. It's got as much to do with that as Julius Malema's expulsion from the Youth League had to do with his insult of President Khama. Nobody cares about those things. There are mega forces operating in the background on which journalists can hang details and historians can hang personalities, but the mega trends in the background are really what's driving this. So NUMSA and COSATU split originally revolved around the unionization of ESCOM workers. There was a fight between NUMSA and NUM about who had the right to organize ESCOM workers. NUM lost that fight, and then also lost membership in the Platinum Belt following the emergence of AMCU. NUM dominated the leadership of COSATU. NUMSA, the metalworkers industry, felt that they should be more prominently represented within the senior office bearers of COSATU, and they were not, and that is why NUMSA has elected to split, though they are more powerful today in terms of membership and influence than the remaining members of COSATU and certainly the National Union of Mine Workers. So, the black working class is under tremendous strain. Unionization is declining for the reason that the economy is modernizing. We've also got a new generation of workers who are perhaps infected by the working class ideology of their parents' generation, but who today could not be more different. Young workers today, if they do find jobs, are much more individualistic. And this also has nothing to do with South Africa, it's got to do with international forces that are driving the working class out of economies and societies everywhere. So, this new generation of workers arises because of tremendous increases in women's education, tremendous increases in the number of women in the workplace, the number of graduates who are women now outnumbers the number who are men, women's pay scales and opportunities have been steadily improving, though they are they still lag behind. Certainly the opportunity and pay gaps have declined consistently, though slowly, since the 1950s. That has reorganized power relations within the household. It's made men more responsible for child rearing and housekeeping activities relative to women. And that change in relationship has made men more interested in flexible working hours and a whole range of things than was the case before. And then finally, I think what's really undermining the black working class is mobility into the middle class. So just to give you a sense of the electoral dynamics at the moment, there are now 10.5 million white-collar workers in South Africa, and there are 5 million blue-collar workers. So out of 53 million people, just over 15 million are employed. Two-thirds of those are in the white-collar workers, and one-third are blue-collar workers. And this proportion is changing all the time. We're finding more and more people engaged in white-collar activities as the economy has modernized, as young workers have sought different working conditions and so on. Of course, the swing factor for South Africa is much broader than just the number of blue-collar workers that includes the unemployed. And the unemployed at nearly 8 million has a significant impact on anyone's electoral calculations. It's certainly the reason why the official opposition has not come out more strongly in favor of the middle class. It's because of the sizable quantum of unemployed people, what Helen Ziller calls economic refugees from the Eastern Cape, who are settling around Cape Town. But there's no question that the working class is in long-term decline in South Africa, and what we're observing is the last fits and starts of the union movements, certainly in the private sector. So, I want to talk a little bit about the growth of the black middle class and how that is measured. The dominant measure of the middle class that is utilized in government circles is based on income. And the problem with income is that incomes don't command the same quantities of economic goods and services over time. So an income 10 years ago compared to an income today had much less command over goods and services. So we've had tremendous technological progress. That technological progress has caused the most incredible revolution in Chinese manufacturing, and China is literally pushing billions and billions of dollars of cheap goods into the rest of the world. And that dramatic change has facilitated the rise in consumption of goods and services among all people everywhere, but particularly among the poor. Hundreds of millions of people have been pulled out of poverty around the world, not primarily because they have found jobs and had rising incomes. The primary effect has been the depression of prices emanating from China and China's expansion. So our measure follows the UCT Unilever Institute, run by Professor John Simpson. He's really found something extraordinary, I think, which is a method to estimate the size of the black middle class based on household consumption activities. Do you have a microwave oven where 10 years ago you had a countertop stove? Do you today have flushing toilets where 20 years ago you had pit latrines? On this basis, the black middle class has grown from 1.8 million people in terms of their power to consume goods and services to at present 5.9 million. Most estimates are smaller than that, And I was chatting to someone earlier, why would the government not like to report this very positive story? You know, the problem with positive stories is that they don't give you an opportunity to adventure, or more importantly, misadventure into the economy, like bad stories do. You know, the fact that I'm overweight, that I smoke, that I drink, and all of these things are grist to Minister Motsoaledi's mill of forcing regulations down my throat and everybody else's. Bad news stories, exploitation of workers, and all the things that are politically interesting, they advance an interventionist agenda, an agenda within government that is well established and propagated by university academics who receive over 20 billion rands worth of funding last year to promote government and government-related research activities. So the academic class has been totally captured by government, and they have a certain agenda, they have a vested interest, and they're not generally interested in good news stories. Something that Leon pointed out to me first in last year's State of the Nation address, which was absolutely incredible that the head of state, President Zuma, gave a three-hour rant about how everything was deteriorating. It was sort of unprecedented in the history of political speeches. Nonetheless, the black middle class, measured by consumption power over goods and services, has grown from 1.8 million to 5.9 million. The number of high-income black South Africans, so that's black South Africans who earn today more than 400,000 a year, and in real terms, the equivalent since 1994, the number of high-income black South Africans has increased from 120,000 to 1.8 million today. Of that increase, only 12% has been in the civil service. And that to me is the most important thing, because a big difference between what is occurring today and what occurred under the emergence of the white middle class was the strategic use of the civil service to absorb poor whites into the mainstream economy. That is not occurring on the same scale or significance today. And I'm going to talk about that, what's undermining the civil service. Nonetheless, the civil service has grown from 1.2 million in 1994 to about 3 million today. That number is not entirely reliable because we didn't have figures for the Bantustans in 1994. So it might have been 1.2 million odd, maybe 1.5 million. Nonetheless, the civil service has certainly grown, but in a way, the growth of the civil service has become self-defeating, because the civil service provides intense pressure on its employer, the state. So if you do this sort of thing as a labor economist, which I've done extensively, you go through individual complaints of the Public Service Commission, you go through individual complaints and court cases at the Public Sector Coordinating Bargaining Council. If you go through the complaints that civil servants make against their employer, the state, two things emerge. The first is, it's way more than ever occurred in the private sector. In the private sector, there are about 2 million business enterprises employing about 15 million people. And those 15 million people make 158,000 cases at the CCMA each year. Though there are some labor court cases, but that's relatively small. That's a tiny fraction in relation to the 12% of civil servants who make cases at the Public Service Commission against the public sector, their employer, every year. So the first point is civil servants are unhappy. And the second point is they're mostly unhappy because managerial capability within the civil service has collapsed. So even though the civil service is moving into the black middle class, they're not the primary source of growth into the black middle class, not even a significant source. And to the extent that they are, they've become more demanding of the state. And you'll know better than I do how many civil servants use government services. So the question that arises, how can we strengthen the black middle class? What's the sort of political agenda, the economic agenda, that would drive the middle class to grow? Well, the first thing that has occurred, I think, is the fragmentation of the radical left. The economic freedom fighters under Julius Malema alarmed people, amused them, I don't know what exactly, but they have a radical leftist agenda of nationalization and other things. The Nomsokosatu split represents the death knell for the working class and the union movement in South Africa. What has happened, I think, is that two bodies that were essential on the left within the ANC are now outside the ANC. And what that has done is shift the center of balance slightly toward the middle. Not much discernibly at present, but I think it will occur over time. These bodies could not find the same home in the ANC today that they had 20 years ago, where this ejection of the radical left was inconceivable. So the radical left has fragmented, and the platform there for Nomsa and Kasatu is the working class, which we see is dwindling, and the economic freedom fighters is really the unemployed, who remain significant, but not really so in relation to what I think the middle class will do over time. So, the two things that I think are central, and that what I'll certainly be driving in my research projects, is firstly, the issue of government schooling, and secondly, the issue of privatization. I think those are two key things. They're not the only things. I think we need income tax reform and we need labor law reform. But in terms of new elements of my research program, I'm going to be looking at those two. Now, government schooling gives me many reasons for optimism. Last year, enrollments at government schools fell by 6%. Which might not sound like a big drop to you, but bearing in mind there are over 12 million people in the government schooling system, that's a significant drop. And the question is, where are those people going? Are they just opting out of schooling? No, they're not. There's a vibrant community of edupreneurs, entrepreneurs who have spontaneously emerged, recruiting retired teachers, paying them better wages, giving them flexibility in the classroom, rewarding them for their in-the-classroom performance, and in the process, displacing the role of government schools. Now, according to the Center for Development and Enterprise, the average fee for a pupil in a low-fee private school is 350 rand a month. Highly affordable, highly competitive, and the growth of low-fee private school enrollments last year was 27%. It doesn't take 10 years of that kind of trend before government schools become a charade about the schooling or otherwise of 386,000 SATU members. So to me, it's extraordinary that the black middle class, including civil servants, is voting with its feet against government-owned and operated schools in favor of private schools, low-fee private schools, and in a way that government recognizes. Government is issuing licenses for over 95% of the schools that apply for them, private schools. Government's been in a long-term battle with teachers' unions from 1996 onwards. Said to refuse to allow inspectors into classrooms. Inspectors were chased away or threatened with murder or whatever. So there's now no external evaluation system for the quality of teaching in a school, in a government school. The second thing is SATU has refused to allow teachers to be evaluated based on the performance of their students. The third thing is SATU was instrumental in the collapse of passing grades in order to push up the percentage passed. It's now a ridiculous situation that a principal in a school may actually have never interviewed a teacher who ends up teaching at that school, government school. said to controls the education system, the government education system in South Africa, and it's extraordinary to me that the private sector has spontaneously emerged with alternatives. Cost effective, high functioning, and in a way that the government is really letting alone. Now, if you think that schooling is important not only to someone's career prospects and especially the first job you get that is so central to your long-term career goals, it also makes you a better citizen, schooling. It makes you more demanding of government services and political behavior. So I would go so far as to say that SADTU is the single biggest cause of long-term inequality of opportunity and incomes in South Africa. If we're talking about income inequality, we have to take the conversation back to the primary reason why black kids cannot find economic opportunities, which is the teachers' unions. So I will fight that fight. The second is privatization. I've done a calculation which indicates that if you take all the state-owned enterprises, for which you probably get nothing if they're unregulated, the only reason you would buy a state-owned enterprise today is if you could persist with its monopoly. But if you privatized these enterprises and they developed along private lines, using private managers, private shareholders, freedom of economic opportunity, the elimination of subsidies and tariffs and things, those enterprises and selected municipal services appropriately deregulated and transferred to the general population would yield a value of about 1.5 trillion rand, which is greater than the government's budget in a year, but not much more. The extraordinary thing is that 1.5 trillion rand could be used to give each household in South Africa cash, or a voucher, or a certificate, or whatever you like, but ultimately cash of 169,000 rand a household. Now you tell me what the working class or the unemployed would do with such a voucher. They may buy a home or put down a deposit on a home. They might use the money as collateral for a loan to educate their children in a private school, low-fee private school. There are many things that the unemployed and the working class would do, and inadvertently what it would do is swell the middle class. So my estimates are that if you could turn around the quality of teaching through these low-fee private schools, and you did a one-off distribution of 169,000 rand to each household in the country, you would expand the black middle class to 11.2 million in 3 to 4 years. In whose economic interests and in whose political interests is that? It's not in the EFF's interests. It's not in the ANC's interests unless the ANC does a serious somersault in the direction of its economic programs, policy programs. It may to some extent be in the interests of the official opposition, but it's got to be something that we put at the center of economic policy proposals because of the effect it will have on the black middle class. And this middle class, I think, in the long term, is the ultimate measure of prosperity and transformation in the country. That's it. That's my story. Some of you are falling asleep.
No.
So, What I would really like more than questions, because, I mean, I can go off for a long time, is comments, really. You know, things that you would suggest for this research program, but you're welcome to ask questions, please.
I'd just like to make a comment about high taxation. High taxation, it doesn't affect the poor people, the so-called working class, and it doesn't affect the very rich people, but it has the effect of wiping out the middle class. So the danger with taxation is that you might end up with a whole lot of wealthy people, so-called fat cats, sitting on top of a whole host of have-nots, and that situation is ripe for a revolution.
Can I just summarize that? Income tax has the potential to wipe out the middle class, black or white or anything. So let me give you some facts about the white middle class and its tax burden. 4% of income taxpayers pay 41% of personal income taxes in a year. So there's an incredibly small base of taxpayers, personal taxpayers, individual income taxpayers, who are contributing nearly half of all income taxes. Another thing that's of interest to me is that, yeah, so anyway, the bottom line is I agree with you. We've got an unsustainable fiscal burden on a very small proportion of the population, but this is what excites me, is that tax evasion is occurring on a very pronounced basis in South Africa. And it's occurring where it matters, which is in the middle class. So I did a simple exercise of correlating the, and this is my econometric history, if you'll excuse me that. I know the Austrians here won't like any sort of econometric analysis, but nonetheless, if you do a simple relationship between the income taxes received, personal income taxes received, and the amount of personal income in a year, you would expect the two to be related, right? As personal incomes rise, personal income tax receipts should rise, right? Guess what? There's a 30% correlation between the two, implying that up to 70% of personal income taxes go unpaid. And that excites me very much. And you will have noticed that in a, okay, so if you want to make a note, please look up my article in the Business Day where I say that South Africa has become a predatory state. And it's become a predatory state in the sense that strategically it only collects tax revenues over-effectively and over-enthusiastically, but it provides almost no government services. And that's my definition of a predatory state as a precursor to a failed state. So look it up in the Business Day. I mean, it sounds lunatic, but they published it. That South Africa is a predatory state. And look in the Sowetan coming up, where I look at SARS charm offensive over the last 20 years and say how it's, I say how it's wearing thin. I don't know if you remember in the middle 90s and early 2000s, SARS' strategy to include people in the tax base was to grant amnesties. Amnesties to businesses, to individuals, to a whole range of people. Slowly that changed. It changed about 7 years ago when SARS, according to its ad agency, launched this advertising campaign called SARS Thanks You. And it ended up a total laughing stock. They withdrew the advertisements because middle-class taxpayers were looking at this and saying, jeepers, I mean, government was showing up, for example, in one advertisement, how an elderly man had had cataracts removed. And the surgeon in the government hospital that they were interviewing, it looked like he could have been sitting in the Politburo. All the desks were from the 50s. Some lights were blinking in the advert. I mean, if they intended this to be a showcase of government performance, it was a laughingstock. And basically, the surgeon in this advertisement had the audacity to say that this is a nerve-wracking procedure. When 98% of cataracts are removed in ophthalmologist offices with 100% success in the private sector. It was a total debacle, that advertising campaign. So notice the progression. Amnesties, SA Thanks You, and guess what the ad company has called their latest campaign? Paranoia. Have you seen any of these ads? So these are adverts about a mainly white middle-class guy with a beer belly and all that sort of thing, and geez, he's sweating about the tax collectors. Okay. So this is the sort of evolution of SARS' attitude toward the population. And you know what people are saying? They're saying, well, I'm one out of 3.8 million who pays any tax, personal income tax. I'm going to take my chances against your 250 inspectors. So I think it's fantastic. I mean, SARS is going to have to spend tremendous amounts of money and energy on collecting those taxes. And I say up to 70% are just not paid. So don't worry about income taxes. The middle class is taking care of it. Yes?
In taking account of middle class income in the public sector, have you attempted to estimate the extent of income through corruption, tender fraud, and everything else. Mm. And then there's a second question. And something that's very strange to me, over the last few years, we've heard all sorts of economic claptrap on 1920s Marxist models.
Yes.
With complete ignorance with reference to history. But where are the seers within our population speaking on economic policy and models and how we can grow the society? Why is there such little debate from that kind of perspective, and even from the universities?
Oh, well, the universities, I'll get going on, but give me a chance.
But not only the universities.
Not only the universities. But the universities have definitely been captured by government research interests. There's no question about that. And Leon and I have an interesting program of getting out of the universities information about which projects are government funded. So watch the space, basically, on the universities. But I remember, I mean, what was funny to me about the Moscow on the Hill comment is that we as students at the time were very right thinking. We saw the irony of calling the place Moscow on the Hill. You know, we could see that what was going on in lectures bore no relationship to what we were interested in as students, which was a happy middle class life. So, you know, as students we knew that what was sort of being spouted forth in these lectures was not received wisdom. We knew that at the time. But anyway, communism seemed to some people the only valid alternative. And of course, you know, it's a catastrophic alternative. Anyway, let me talk about bribery and corruption a little bit. Don't worry. Bribes are subject to the same competitive behavior that all economic activities are subject to. Okay? And I'll give you a little anecdotal example. I have a farm in Kruit Marika, Herman Charles Bosman country. It's a country of anarchists, which I say because I assume there's some fellow travelers here. But nonetheless, I didn't know all of this beforehand. But anyway, in Kruit Marika, about 80% of the farm workers are Zimbabwean. And you may not know that 3.5 million Zimbabweans sought work in South Africa after Mugabe's mental evacuation in 2001. 3.5 million is a big number, right? If we only employ 15 million people and 686,000 in agriculture. The question that's always occupied me is, why did those Zimbabweans find work and South Africans in similar number can't find work? That's a separate issue. I mean, the answer is, the Zimbabweans were not protected by labor laws and they didn't have minimum wages. That's the bottom line, but it's a long story. Nonetheless, what interested me in asking these farm workers about, you know, various things, is over time the progression of bribes at Bytebridge. The system of bribery and corruption at Bytebridge is now so sophisticated, okay, that they advertise on boards what the bribe is for that day, okay? And there's a differential bribe. It costs more to enter South Africa than to leave, okay? Representing, I suppose, relative economic merits of the two countries. Over time, that has been competed downward. It now costs 200 rand to enter South Africa and 170 rand to exit. It's now reached such laughable proportions that people with documents, valid, legitimate work permits and other permits, prefer to use the bribe queue than the legitimate queue, where people wait for up to 12 or 36 hours. So don't worry about bribery. Bribery is part of the free market mechanism asserting its relevance in the context where some impediments, usually a governmental impediment, impinges on the economy. Is that convincing? I don't worry about it, in other words. Yes, Azar.
Hello, Len. Thank you for a very thought-provoking presentation. I'm often confronted with a question, or the question arises in my own mind, and I'd like your comment regarding the parallel between the apartheid government trying to suppress education of the masses,
yes,
to sustain power, and the view that the leadership within government, and maybe the, is also following that path or trying to, and what I read between the lines from what you're saying is maybe Sattu is the vehicle through which that is taking place, precisely because they feel threatened by the rise of the middle class.
Yeah, if you wanted to take a conspiracy theory, and you might have found many in what I'm saying, but this in my mind qualifies as a conspiracy. Perhaps it is a concerted effort to keep black kids poor and unskilled. You know, maybe that is one of the logical conclusions of government schooling in this country as it's being conducted. I'm not too concerned about that. I mean, you know, the emergence of these low-fee private schools is just to me a fantastic phenomenon. It represents the extraordinary power we have in the private sector. I did a calculation of the return on shareholders' funds, which I think is the relevant return. You know, in other words, bondholders you can liquidate, but shareholders you need to entertain. The return on shareholders' funds, in other words, the capital actually contributed to the firm, in South Africa is about 27.2%, currently the highest out of 25 countries in the world. Now, you could use that as a stick to beat the private sector, because if returns are more than 20% and the cost of capital is down at 8%, why are you not expanding so that the returns come down and the cost of capital rises? Why are you not reaching that point? That is what economic growth is pursuing profitable opportunities until the opportunities disappear. But I think there are many problems that go with that. I mean, corporations are sitting with over 750 billion rand in cash on their balance sheets at the moment. And they're reluctant to invest it despite these very high returns because there is concern about the future. They're not freely allowed to invest due to exchange controls. Now, South Africa has a magnificent private sector. I think we're in very, very good shape. And we have a failing state. That's the bottom line. And everything will resolve itself around how those two things interact. If the failing state causes the private sector to become permanently reluctant to invest, we've got serious problems. If the private sector becomes corrupt in a way that, for example, the construction companies could become in the face of R1 trillion worth of infrastructure investment projects over the next 15 years, that would be a major problem. But so far, things are in the most divine equilibrium. The state is failing. People are not observing their tax obligations, and the private sector is flourishing. I don't even know if that answers your question, but it seemed like a nice story. Yes.
How does the disintegration of COSATU play out with the strength of the ANC? Do you think the ANC are going to significantly lose support by the next election as a result of COSATU's, I mean, the interaction between COSATU and the ANC?
You know, I went to...
Logic would tell you yes, presumably.
On the Thursday night before the votes were counted, votes were cast but not counted. On the Thursday night beforehand, the DA was 55% ahead in Gauteng, and there was only Soshanguve to count. And I thought, well, the DA has won the day. And I woke up the next morning, and Soshanguve had won it for the ANC. And I was amazed that the whole thing turned on Soshanguve. And there is no question in my mind that unless the ANC develops a credible platform for black prosperity and middle class prosperity in particular, they will lose the next provincial election in Gauteng. There's no question.
And the
COSATU, you can forget about it. COSATU's had it. They are now in permanent decline. They will never recover from this collapse. And I say that not because of the personalities or the events or the history or this or that. It's because of the seismic events that are in the background of COSATU's disintegration. Yes.
How are you?
Fine, thank you.
Thanks. I think earlier you spoke about back then, I think in the early 1904 or something in your slides.
Okay, 1904 was the first white trade union.
The
1911 was the first racial segregation legislation, something around that time.
Okay. I think we're talking about white unions who were blocking the black people from entering the market. Do you sense that today, given the kind of energy we see around the country in terms of unions and demanding of higher wages, the protests and all that, do you conclude similarly that the intent or the objective of the unions in general is to try and block competition from those
young black people?
Yeah.
Look, union members we know have an average age of 43. They have 17 years of work experience on average, and they're overwhelmingly black. Job seekers have an average age of 24. They have no work experience. 52% of them have never worked in their lives before, and they are overwhelmingly black. Trade unions today representing the interests of better paid, more experienced, higher skilled black people are excluding from competition young, inexperienced, less well-paid people. Why does COSATU oppose labor brokers? Because over the last 20 years, labor brokers have introduced 1.4 million people into the world of work in South Africa. Why does COSATU oppose the youth wage subsidy, the so-called economic, employment tax incentive or something? Why do they oppose it? Because it's going to benefit and subsidize primarily the entry of young black people into the workforce, people earning under 6,000 rand a month. Why does COSATU want to introduce a national minimum wage? Because anyone whose productivity falls below that national minimum wage, which in South Africa is about 7 million people, COSATU is proposing a minimum wage of 4,500 rand a month, which is the minimum living level, so-called. 7 million people earn less than that. What COSATU wants to do is exclude those people who are in the informal sector, in informal enterprises, in construction companies, in people that have no interest to COSATU as a membership group. They want to exclude those people, primarily young people, from the world of work. So you can look up many of my articles on COSATU. I've been writing about them for the better part of a decade. And there's one in particular where Peter Bruce gave me a whole page in the Business Day to set forth my schemes around COSATU. This was something we anticipated 10 years ago, and you can see it now disintegrate.
Yeah, just one more question. I think you said in agriculture and mining since 1994,
yes,
there's been a decline of the working.
Massive decline.
Massive decline. What has happened to productivity? Has it gone up? Production within those sectors.
Okay, there's an economist's argument and then there's a sort of realist's argument. The economist's argument is that productivity has been rising, and productivity is defined for most parts output per worker. Now, what makes that a bit of an artifact is that if output rises and the number of workers used to produce that output falls, output per worker rises. So you could have a situation where output is rising, the labor force is declining, and it looks like productivity is increasing. So what you've got to do is you've got to look at productivity of labor, excluding the alternatives to labor, like capital equipment, machinery, automation, mechanization, and so on. And if you look at the marginal productivity of labor, it's at the lowest point in 45 years. Because, it doesn't make sense, does it, that firms would be economizing on the use of labor and labor productivity is growing 7, 8, 9% a year. But it depends. You'll have a debate with economists about how best to measure it. But for me, the only sensible thing is that the marginal productivity of labor is falling and maybe even negative.
So just two questions. The numbers you show on unemployment.
Yes.
One, do they include just formal employment? And do they include 3.5 million Zimbabwean workers?
Okay, it's a good question. Yeah, that's
just
one.
The second one is, in terms of this growth, how much of the black population directly linked to the black economic empowerment legislation.
Okay. Firstly, black economic empowerment is not black economic empowerment, the way that I understand what black economic empowerment is. What has occurred over the last 20 years is not the economic empowerment of blacks. What has occurred is something that Anthea Jeffrey from the Institute of Race Relations has exposed in a wonderful new book that I really must recommend to you. Where she looks in detail at every transaction of any significance in the history of BEE in South Africa, in post-apartheid South Africa, and she concludes that it was a terrible disaster. So Anthea would probably describe it in a very different way, but she's the author of the book. I suggest you read it. It is a fascinating book. So that's the second question. The first question relates to what is included in the employment figures? That's only recognized employment by StatsSA. What I call the informal sector, which is unrecognized employment, in other words, unofficial employment, is substantially bigger than that.
I hear your first answer, but I think that's often the answer that is given towards this. Black economic empowerment is a lot more than just at a transactional level, at an equity level. Enterprise development, there's managerial positions that people are given, there's employment, there's five, six different measurements of black empowerment. And I think I would agree that at a transactional equity level, that is true. But when you look at the effects throughout, when you look at the development of black entrepreneurs through enterprise development, through state, genderpreneurs, whatever you want to call them, and take all of that into account as economic empowerment, not just the transactions that we themselves, I think you come to a different
No, what I'm saying to you is, if you define BEE as excluding what has happened to the rich, BEE has failed. So for example, government uses the number of blacks in managerial positions as its central indicator of black economic advancement in the workplace. The problem is, only 5% of positions in the total labor force are managerial positions. What on earth are you looking at managerial positions for if 95% of the positions and occupations available in the economy have nothing to do with management? I mean, a third of positions in South Africa are professional and technical professional occupations. So please do read Dr. Jeffrey's book. It sheds incredible lights on the subject, even if we discount completely the super rich. If you evaluate it by the effect it's had on the median black person in South Africa, it's been a spectacular failure.
I just want to say we haven't arranged breakfast. So we've come at what officially is the sort of closing time, but I see so much interest. What I want to suggest is that, I don't know how much longer, take a fixed number of questions, or are you happy just to carry on? We've only paid him until now. That's the I suggest you order breakfast.
Yeah, but my marginal productivity after this is zero.
So. we can't replace him with technology either. We're working on it. I don't know.
No, carry on. I don't mind. When people start to leave, we'll.
When the drainage exceeds the, what did you call it? Mugabe's
brand. It's mental evacuation.
When the evacuation exceeds the question. Yeah.
We just heard all the good news, the decline of the working class black, all this sort of thing. What about this enormous unemployment we have? Can we compare a country like South Africa, say, to Britain, who could dispense with their manufacturing and just go into the service industry and this sort of thing? We see this, the output is declining all the time. We spoke about the mines just now, but if you look at the figures, actual production is declining. Shouldn't we look at a situation where we've got 100,000 additional workers at 2,000 rand a month, then the 12,000 rand.
You know, I don't want to discount the services sector. I mean, when I was at Moscow on the Hill, and I made a living and helped myself study and keep my myself alive through waitering. We would always joke as waiters, it was an inside joke, that we were serving out-of-work actors who were entertaining other out-of-work actors on their days off. And that's the services industry. It's people serving one another in areas of skill and need. You know, as people become richer, they require financial services to invest for the future. And maybe I should just tell you what I think are the key characteristics of the middle class. And I've still got to concern myself with this word class, because it's something that doesn't fit so well with the free market paradigm. But nonetheless, in looking at the black middle class, there's certain characteristics that stand out. Home ownership is without question the first. Saving for retirement is the second. Good quality education for their children, that's the third. Skill acquisition, work experience, and upward mobility. In almost every one of those, the financial sector is involved in financing education, financing mortgages, providing mortgages on home loans, and so on and so forth. The financial services sector is absolutely central to the evolution of a prosperous and happy economy. So I'm not too concerned about this argument that arises from the Ricardian experiment in economics about, you know, who still produces the shoes. You don't have to worry about that. You know, it's a myth, I think, that some people still have to produce shoes in an advanced services economy. I mean, Hong Kong is a classic example of how the services sector can just explode without limits. But to talk about your question specifically, and I don't want to get bogged down, my estimates are that if you include the informal sector properly, you will find that the unemployment rate in South Africa is somewhere between 11 and 13%, not 25 to 35% as the government estimates. I've had terrific fights with the Statistician General about this. He was delighted. He wrote to me that I'd moved to the Free Market Foundation, and he was saying he really will miss the fights we've had. And I replied to him that those fights will intensify, unrestrained by AdCorp's public persona. So that's the short answer, but there is a long answer.
We're talking about universities. Yes. I'd just like you to comment. Murray Rothbard says the role of the intellectuals in society was to justify the existence and the policies of the state.
That was Murray, and I think he had good antecedents. The one who first, maybe these arguments have been made for a long time in wealthy societies, but the one who stands out for me is Schumpeter. And he does, because he's quite a good example. He wasn't Austrian, and he certainly wasn't an Orthodox Austrian, but Schumpeter indicated that that economic prosperity was self-defeating, because it created a class of people whose primary activity was intellectual leisure, and those he called intellectuals. And he felt that intellectuals' opposition to commercial and economic activity would ultimately limit the growth of capitalism in capitalist countries. We haven't observed that kind of limitation. It doesn't seem that a very expansive intellectual class in the United States, the greatest economy the world has ever known, it doesn't seem that the vigor of that class, the intellectual class, in the United States has limited its economic performance or potential to any significant extent.
It's got wild city, never saw any of that.
Yeah, but I don't know. We've got to take a very long look at history if we're talking about things like that. You know, we'll argue about what caused the decline of the Roman Empire and the decline of Christendom and all those things.
But overall, I perceive in South Africa there is a very strong, what von Mises called the anti-capitalistic mentality. You know, the fact that people work for profit is considered immoral by a lot of people.
Business people included. And when I say business people, I mean managers rather than shareholders.
Yeah.
I often hear managers make excuses. We were talking about this earlier. This whole corporate social investment nonsense.
Oh, yes.
You know, it's sort of because of the rise of human resources in the modern corporation that people have said, you know, we really need to show our commitment to the community. I mean, Adam Smith's answer, and I think rightly, is that doing business is your contribution to the economy and
exactly.
society.
Exactly.
And I think it's a sufficient contribution.
I mean,
other things contribute. I mean, the evidence is that where government is not involved, private philanthropy provides all the poor with needed services. And
yes,
certainly
yes.
that was true before the 1950s in the United
yes,
States.
Yes, yes, yes.
So, yeah, I think business people also have this bias, but it arises from the differences in motive between the manager and the shareholder, because the shareholder is very narrowly interested in value maximization, and managers have other objectives sometimes.
I mean, the whole point, as I see it, is that the reason why a lot of people in the world have food on the table and a roof over their head, business activity and nothing else. If there were no business activity, those people would not have food on their table, they would not have a roof over their heads.
You're preaching to the choir, you're singing to the choir. I couldn't agree with you more. What I'm trying to do is get that message out there with Leon's encouragement. I'm trying to find a column in one of the great black newspapers in the country, or magazines possibly, to try and write about issues related to the black middle class in one way or another. And certainly it would be to propagate those ideas.
Yeah.
The value. I mean, many bright young blacks in South Africa are persuaded into the civil service, which is a catastrophe.
Yes.
And, you know, there's lots. Ideas that the white middle class learned in the 3 decades of stagnation before Mandela and de Klerk sort of miraculously found the end of apartheid. You know, the stagnation of the white and black middle and working classes over those 3 decades demonstrated to me absolutely the problems that that existed between apartheid and business corporations. But the main problem today among the black middle class is the assumption that apartheid was a capitalist system. It's widespread, it's absolutely widespread.
It's the exact opposite of that.
Of course, it's totally the back opposite. I mean, if you see how the Nationalist Party began in the white trade union movement, you can see immediately the problems that...
They were like the Labour Party in Britain.
Yeah. Well, there was a Labour Party, and that was part of the problem.
Yeah.
Yes.
Sorry,
no. I have taken too many. You have, but I'll come back to you.
Thank you.
Perhaps you're the best person to pose this question to. What would be the short answer to the union's argument regarding labor brokers, that the jobs labor brokers offer, or claim to offer, the fact that labor brokers claim to offer jobs is a fallacy, and that those jobs really lie with companies themselves, and that companies are just throwing money to labor brokers to obviously circumvent employment laws.
Yeah. I think firstly, if you've got the labor brokers managers in a private conference, they'd say to you, yes, of course we're circumventing labor laws. You know, why do you think we exist? And I think that's absolutely correct. But the point is not to ban labor brokers, it's to revise the labor laws that gave rise to them in the first place. But I'd like to add a little bit of nuance to that, because it's not quite so clear cut. There is hostility in a certain kind of radical leftist toward the middleman in anything. And that means there is a resentment about paying an estate agent a commission. There is a resentment about paying a bank a margin. on their interest rates. There is a resentment about labor brokers earning a charge of the people they deploy. There is this tremendous hostility in among many people toward the intermediary. And that's what labor brokers are. They are intermediaries. I mean, if they placed people in permanent jobs, they would charge 20% of the first year's remuneration. Because those people employed in temporary jobs don't have a full year of employment, they charge them per hour, also 20%. You don't earn more because you're a provider of temporary workers, but you make a charge per hour because that's the basis on which the people work. On all these questions, you'll find some of my thoughts just searching for it on the internet. I'll probably pop up on each of these issues somewhere. But it's a fallacy, it's a pervasive fallacy in understanding of the economy to discount the role of the intermediary. And they play a vital role. If you think of the intermediary as providing information, a bank provides information about lenders to borrowers through some intermediate mechanism. Labor brokers collect information about the skills available and the jobs available. And the matching of that information is absolutely crucial if you think how important human resources are to the modern corporation. But look for my stuff. You'll find lots of apologetics in my work. Yes.
Do you detect an antipathy towards free market thinking and truth from Christian clergy?
Yes. I remember I went to dinner the other night and I irritated a priest, a Roman Catholic priest. I was seated next to him and I said to him, I was tired and I wasn't really thinking, and I said to him, "Father, how's business?" And he thought that was exceedingly funny.
Yeah.
But it was really a fluke on my part. But I don't engage much with clergy, with the rabbinates, with the mullahs. I don't engage much with the religious people. But there is this idea that Christianity is consistent with or inconsistent with market principles and market mechanisms. The idea that the first will be last and the poor will be rich and all of those ideas. There is a revisionist view emerging in the United States about which the FMF director Jason Erbach will be able to tell you more. I'm an agnostic and he chides me because he's an atheist, but he says to me that there is important revisionist work going on in the United States about resurrecting the original biblical principles of Christianity and framing them in terms of the market mechanism. So the answer is, in the popular understanding, Christianity is probably seen to be a valid basis for communitarianism in one form or another. I mean, but that's not true of Christianity alone. I mean, the Dalai Lama has said in his many appearances in Los Angeles and in Hollywood, in front of big auditoriums of people, that he favors a communist model. I don't think it's uniquely Christian. But in fact, you could make the argument that Christianity is consistent with the kind of intellectual rationalism and freedom that is associated with the emergence in relatively recent times of the free market system. So I don't know. I don't have a personal view. Contact Jason and look up this work burgeoning in the United States of free market apologetics for Christianity.
Thank you.
The ANC's hostility towards free market principles and the marketplace, do you think that the black middle class will have any influence on that?
I think the ANC has a choice. Does it follow the middle class where it's going and the political platforms and agendas that are important to it, or does the ANC lose relevance? And the answer to that question is probably the most important in South Africa today. Because we've seen from recent behavior that the ANC will not go quietly. And if they make a misguided strategic own goal in terms of the black middle class, I think we have serious problems ahead. But it's much more likely that the electoral calculus will drive the ANC in the end. And you know, what I'm presenting here is a possibility for the next 3 or 4 years and an emergence over the last 20 years. I think it will occur and it will continue for the better part of the century. So there's a lot of time for the ANC to change course. I think what we're observing is rather more President Zuma than the ANC at the moment. Leon has done some great work about the liberal, in the classical sense, the classical liberal roots of the ANC. And I was very interested to see in the expulsion of COSATU that the vote was relatively narrow. I'm also interested to see that as much as the ANC likes to present a unified opinion after conferences, there's vigorous debate occurring there. So I wouldn't underestimate the classical liberal wing within the ANC. As Leon's argued before to me, the ANC actually had that basis originally. But I think there are dangerous signs about what will happen if the ANC doesn't follow the middle class where it's going.
Thank you.
I think that's enough.
Yeah.
Okay, thanks guys.